It's my great pleasure to be speaking again to Matthew Ehret, who is a prolific Canadian author and speaker and editor-in-chief of the Canadian Patriot Review and co-founder of the Montreal-based Rising Tide Foundation. Besides copious articles, he has authored four volumes of the Untold History of Canada book series and has a new book out, which essentially continues that series, called The Clash of Two Americas, Volume One, The Unfinished Symphony. So there's still a Volume Two coming out. So that's great. Yeah. And I guess your book is available on your website, which is CanadianPatriot.org. And I know it's on Amazon too, for anybody who uses Amazon. Okay. Yeah. So great to speak to you. I actually meant to just skim your book so I could ask intelligent questions. And it was so interesting. I wound up reading practically the whole thing. I'm going blind here, but I got through it. It was great. It was really interesting for me. I mean, I consider myself, you know, an expert on American history, and there are lots of things I didn't know, and it explained lots of things I didn't, you know, added new light through new light on old issues. So that was great. And it's cool to me that you're Canadian, and yet you've taken such an interest in American history. But then, as you point out, Canada could have been, or might, you know, the plan of Benjamin Franklin and his cohort of his colleagues was to bring Canada in among many other countries, and that didn't work out. So you can talk about that as you will, but I wanted to start with your title, The Clash of Two Americas, which is provocative, and The Unfinished Symphony, which is provocative. So do you want to say what the two Americas are and what's not finished here?
Yeah, sure. Absolutely. And again, it's always great to chat with you, Ellen. Thank you for providing the platform for this dialogue to happen. And I hope that some of your viewers get something out of this. I know for myself as a Canadian, I often get a lot of Americans who express what you just said. And they're like, well, how is it that you're so concerned about American history? And, you know, sometimes it's useful to just get out of your field of comfort, your perception as an American looking at your own history, and sometimes just having another person, whether a European or whether an Asian or whether a Canadian, looking gives sometimes a new dimension, a new element to appreciate the context. Since Canada itself, a lot of people take for granted that this just exists as a nation, that they're all, you know, they look at the globe and they're like, okay, there's these nation states in the world with these cultural dynamics in each nation state. And it's just sort of, they just happen to be there, and it's taken as an a priori fact. But the evolution of how this came to be is often not fresh in people's minds. So why is there a Canada? Why is there a monarchy of the North in North America? The only country that has a monarchy in all of the Americas. Why? We are, by all intents and purposes, very American. I don't, you know, if you asked a Slovakian to detect which one you or me was American and which Canadian, I don't think they would find it very easy. So
one word that Canadians say that I can always tell it's Canadian, but other than that, it's like indistinguishable.
What's the word? Is it?
I don't remember. If I hear you say it, I'll tell you. Or what's one sound, you know.
What's it about?
Sorry. But, you know, I hear people, and then, you know, they're talking along, and all of a sudden I just hear this sound and I go,
Yeah, there's tells you can get. But overall, it's difficult, especially, you know, we come from a similar cultural dynamic. You know, we watch similar movies, shows, music, speak the same language for the most part. I'm here in Quebec, where we speak two languages. But how did this all happen? Why are we a separate country? And you inferred very quickly to one of the early chapters in my new book, The Clash of the Two Americas. I have a hard copy here, The Unfinished Symphony. And I try to address that. And I try to do that from the standpoint of looking at the past, not from the standpoint simply of documenting things that happened, but rather seeing that history is shaped by aborted potentials on the one hand. So potentials that were moving into being, that were being actualized, but were aborted. And at in the other hand, tragedies, things that should not have happened, which did happen. So, and then I would add a third category of things that likely were never going to happen, potentials that were almost impossible. If you were a gambler, you would not have guessed that the US Revolution was going to be a success when you had a bunch of farmers with no industry in the colonies rebel against the biggest empire in the world, right? A global force. You would have been like, no way, my money's on the British Empire. But that potential ended up actualizing. So you have those things too. And you have these, so there's sort of a dynamic interplay. It's not, looking at Canada from that standpoint, was a journey. It took many years of research. I pulled together a news magazine on called the CanadianPatriot.org back in 2012 to start publishing some of the historical research and some of the geopolitical analysis associated with that. Some of your work on web of debt and public banking came in very handy in trying to understand how the Bank of Canada was taken down. How did it come to being? How was it taken down? How could it be reactivated to fund infrastructure in our modern age? So all of that was very useful. But the broader question still remained, why are we not part of the United States? Now, a lot of Canadians would be like, well, thank God we're not. And sure enough, when you do look at the United States' behavior in recent decades, you can't blame somebody for saying, thank God we're not. Because
that's part of the Unfinished Symphony. So what you're saying is we didn't actually manifest what we set out to manifest. I mean, what I really liked about your, for one thing I liked besides all the facts that I didn't know, is that it, you know, it restores our faith in what America was all about and what it was intended to be. And it didn't get there, but it didn't get there because it got subverted by those, I mean, as Lincoln and Henry Carey said, you know, you've got two systems. That's what you said, in fact, the clash of two Americas. So the two Americas, do you want to define what that is? I mean, it was the British system, the imperialist influence, which was largely financial, that just kept cutting in and cutting us off and doing all those things that we've got a bad name for.
Exactly. And that's where it's an important lesson for Canadians as well as Americans to recall that the American Revolution, though it lasted for 6 years, it finally had a peace treaty in 1783 in Paris. It was never a final product. You had Ben Franklin, his loyal allies who shared a vision for creating a new type of government founded upon the consent of the governed, the general welfare, which was the foundation of the Constitution in 1787. And the principle of the inalienable rights of each individual, no regard whatsoever for hereditary class. The idea of organizing society around hereditary power structures is entirely the foundation of every type of government that had ever existed before 1776. So sometimes you could have a more benevolent king or, you know, monarch that would give of some more liberties than others to a colony or another. But the idea of conceptually was that those liberties were given by the consent of only one sovereign. There's only one sovereign being that gave or could take away, inversely, your liberties. In the United States, that was it was the first time a nation was organized around a different idea that everybody was sovereign, not just one, like the Canadian system. And so the entire political economy was expected to emanate that truth. And it is a truth. It's founded in an idea of natural law. So coming out of the 1783, and the picture on the book is from Benjamin West, an American painter from Philadelphia who ended up becoming president of the British Royal Academy of Fine Arts, which is a whole story unto itself. He was a close friend of Benjamin Franklin. And on it, you have the American delegation, but it's an unfinished painting. And the British refused to sit for that painting because in their minds, in the minds of people like Lord Shelburne, they didn't really truly accept the terms of conditions of the American claim for independence. The idea was always to recapture it at some future time. So they didn't show up. And so it was an unfinished painting, but I think it speaks loudly and it's very appropriate. The
You know, we're on radio, so a lot of people aren't going to see that.
Oh, we're on radio right now? Oh, okay, I didn't know that.
No, not right now, but I mean...
It will be. Yeah. Okay. So I'll stop describing things that you can visually see. Okay.
Yeah, you gotta say your graphics with words. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So basically you have Benjamin Franklin sitting at a painting with John Adams, his nephew, a couple of others, John Jay, in Paris for the signing of the peace treaty of the Peace of Paris, and the painter is Benjamin West. And again, it's, as your listeners might've guessed, it's an unfinished painting because, you know, and so the point is that when you look at what happened in the ensuing years, especially after Ben Franklin died, you had groupings of Americans that said early on they were not going to be a part of the revolution and that they instead preferred to be a part of the British Empire. And that encompassed the city of London as the international financial hub around the Bank of England that to this very day remains an international node of control. It implied also British intelligence and everything that went with the British East India Company, eventually the growth of the opium trade and other things, money laundering, the slave trade was largely driven economically by this structure. So one group said they wanted to be a part and remain loyal to that. That became the British United Empire Loyalists, who became English-speaking Canada. You had some Canadians, some French Canadians, who wanted to be a part of the revolution. And that's when Benjamin Franklin was up here organizing. And they were basically threatened with excommunication and burning in hellfire for eternity by Bishop Briand and a bunch of Jesuits who were loyal to the British way of doing things. And basically said, if anybody fights with Washington, yeah, you're going to burn in hell forever. So that dissuaded more than a few farmers from joining the cause. And it certainly dissuaded any delegates from being formed to go to the American Constitutional Convention in 1776. So you had the those who just left, they became English-speaking Canada and loyalists. That created its own oligarchy around what later became called the Family Compact and had its own, to this very day, a lot of these same family structures and institutions remain very powerful in Canada. The other group that remained loyal to the British remained behind and simply said, okay, a lot of them found themselves inside of Hamilton's Federalist Party. Not Hamilton. And I make that point in the book that Hamilton stood out from his own party because he was loyal to Ben Franklin's vision. But they basically said, we are going to work to subvert the United States from within. And from there, we have the groupings around the Cabot family, the Eastern Blue Blood establishment, what sometimes were called the Boston Brahmins. They call them the Brahmins because in India, that's the highest caste, right? So you had this grouping that essentially organized themselves very, very much around not just Burr, but an entire web of British assets inside of America to take down the United States from within. And this became sort of the bane of America's existence that to this very day has not been purged. And that's the second America. So there's two Americas at war with each other, a legitimate one. And usually you could tell, you could see its representatives by the fact that when they achieve the presidency, they don't live through their terms of office. And there's been 8 presidents who did not make it through, whether by bullets or whether by very mysterious circumstances, likely poisoning. And you'll find that usually they're doing something very, very similar to each other, even though they're separated by many decades apart.
And they were all in favor of the American system versus the British system. Yeah.
That's the common denominator, and that is the punchline.
Yeah. do you want to list them? So, I mean, I think I...
Sure, yeah.
Go
ahead. I'll see what I can do. I'll see how my memory works here. But you have definitely... the first American president to die was a Whig president named William Harrison in 1840, who had the draft for a reactivation of a third... the renewal of a third national bank on his desk. It had been passed in both the Senate and the Congress. So it was about to happen. He was about to sign off on it when he died after only 3 months in office. Both John Quincy Adams and Abraham Lincoln campaigned vigorously for his success after a tumultuous period of a Jackson presidency as well as a Van Buren presidency, which unfortunately, even though both characters, especially Jackson, are somewhat overly celebrated in our modern age for having paid off the debt. And, you know, you hear these different mythologies about how Jackson went to war with the big bankers, the big international proto Federal Reserve private bankers and beat the bank. And that's what's on his tombstone. No, that's a mythology cooked up by those very same bankers who took control of the United States under Jackson. And you could just see the way, what he did is he did pay the debt, it's true, by cutting all investment into big infrastructure projects and simply putting that all into paying the debt. But it's like what the IMF has expected of all countries, you know, including Greece and others, that if they're going to get a loan, they have to have conditionalities to pay the debt and stop investing in infrastructure. So that's what sort of happened. The U.S. ground to a halt, and it became a speculative frenzy where every state was given the right to issue their own currencies. Anyway, that's a whole story. And you asked me a question of the list of dead presidents. So Harrison, not to to keep myself on track here. So Harrison was the first to die after 3 months. You had the Whigs reorganizing.
Can I just interject? Yeah. So my great, great, great grandfather, it was named William Henry Harrison Miles, and he fought at Gettysburg, and he homesteaded, you know, 160 acres in Pennsylvania. So, you know, so I feel all warm and attached to all that. But I just heard, I sent you this video, I just heard today that the problem with the Homestead Act, but this is a totally different subject, is that all those Western settlers were moving in on property that we didn't really own. I mean, it was that indigenous peoples that were being invaded. And that's why there's this, I mean, one of the themes of your book is that this whole movement about rewriting American history, that it was all, you know, rich white men taking away the lands of poor people and enslaving poor people and that sort of thing. That was not really the American, that wasn't the point. There was another faction that was doing all that. But anyway, that was too bad.
No, we can get back to that later.
That's a whole topic. That's my William Henry Harrison story. You don't care, but I have his shaver and his toothbrush and some mementos from the Civil War, some letters talking about, you know, wormy food and, you know, how bad conditions were.
Interesting. That's really interesting. I mean, William Harrison was not he's not somebody that most people are aware of, because, you know, he was
my grandfather's only 3 months. Probably born at the same time or so.
Maybe. And this is your great, 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 whatever grandfather.
Yeah.
Amazing. And he was active in the Civil War.
Well, he fought in the Civil War. I don't know. I mean, he's certainly nobody famous, but okay. I'm just saying it's, you know, it rings a bell. And I mean, I've always identified with that. I remember going to Gettysburg and checking out all the gravestones and that sort of thing. Anyway, it is disturbing when you hear all these negative things about, well, even when I was in college, you know, when you first learned that America is not all those wonderful things that you were told it was, and that we're doing all these terrible things in Latin America, et cetera. And that was, for me, that was during the Vietnam War. So it was, you know, a dark period.
Yeah, so, well, I think that the two biggest threats to the truth of history is two bad habits of historiography. On the one hand, of those historians who try to paint everything from a standpoint of the U.S. is an angelic country that's perfect. It's a, like, the American Revolution is a done deal. It happened. The U.S. is now the best. And everything that, you know, so they'll sort of paint every core singularity in history after 1776 as America was completely great. And they'll overlook all sorts of very ugly, disturbing things that were done in America's name. On the other hand, and that leads you all the way up through the assassinations of world leaders in South America, Operation Condor, it'll, you know, you'll just ignore all sorts of stuff in the Middle East, in Africa, and you name it. And then the other hand, you have the very cynical narratives that only are capable of looking at everything from the standpoint of America is evil. It's always been evil, and it always will be evil, and it's kind of good that it collapses. So and there that narrative, that filter, is incapable of receiving anything positive that might contradict that very, very solid assumption that is unbreakable. And you have from there things like the 1619 Project, which I think a great example, that premises itself on the narrative that, you know, America was entirely always built not on slavery, number one, on the expansion of slavery, the empowerment of the slave master, and all basically white European males who are in America are intrinsically just spreading their vile, poisonous you know, desire to dominate all weaker genders and races, and thus that must be overthrown. And there's an inability to often see any, well, good, virtuous white European males who didn't believe in that, you know.
No, that's another great theme in your book, that, you know, Lincoln and Carey and the heroes that were celebrating, Franklin, were definitely anti-slavery, and Lincoln really did fight the Civil War to free the slaves and not just to preserve the Union, as some people say. When I got to, you quoted Frederick Douglass, who was one of the few emancipated slaves who could actually read and write. And I mean, it was quite moving to me, and I got choked up reading what he said.
Well, that brought tears to my eye too. And actually, I forgot to mention, that was my wife, because my wife, Cynthia Chung, who's also a writer at Strategic Culture with me, wrote two of the chapters in the book, and that was hers. She brought that to my attention after reading Frederick Douglass's autobiography. And yeah, you could just really recognize that the entire idea, and it's so popular that Lincoln really didn't care about slaves or freeing the slaves. He just really cared about freeing the Union or saving the Union, which is an oft-cited quote, is completely taken out of context. And it ignores the entire life's work of Lincoln going back to the 1830s as a lawyer and as a young congressman working with John Quincy Adams, where he was always fighting against the institution of slavery. He always. It just so happened to be at that moment, I guess that this was leading up to or during the Civil War, that quote occurred. He was making the point simply that if you allow the United States to dissolve as the Union is concerned and undo the Constitution and undo the Declaration and all of that, the ability to stop slavery is going to be forever gone. Like, forget about it. At that point, if you have a dissolved Union with a pro-British
slave. Yeah.
Huh? Yeah, it was still anti-slavery. It was just not, you know, he's also fighting a political, you know, fight with constituencies who don't necessarily have his views, that he needs to still have their support. So often what a political statesman will say publicly is versus what they're thinking are not the same thing. And that's something a lot of people naively or romantically ignore. In real politics, you have to look at what the person's actions are over what simply they say, because often what they say is deflection from what their higher intention is. Otherwise, no good guy or girl or whatever in history would ever succeed at fighting empire ever.
Yeah. So, and Douglas said, you know, having met him several times, that he was convinced of his sincerity and that it was really all about freeing the slaves and that was really important to him.
All right.
Yeah.
You asked me about the other dead presidents. Do you want to go through the list?
Oh, sure. Go ahead.
Okay.
Sorry.
I go on tangents and then it invokes questions in your mind too. I understand. So I'll just keep it straight. So you have then Zachary Taylor, 1851. He was also another Whig who died very, very quickly. According to historians, the official cause of death was bad milk and cherries. Yeah, sure. And then obviously we all know Lincoln in 1865. Which I have a whole chapter on going through the role of British operations in Canada on that one, that ran and deployed John Wilkes Booth from Montreal. There's a whole story about that. Then obviously you have Garfield in 1880, around the same time, a little bit before Tsar Alexander II also was killed by a British connected anarchist cell in Moscow. Then you have the vice president of McKinley who dies. Many, many works have been written on the fact that, and this guy was a very strong figure. I'm forgetting his name all of a sudden, but he likely died by arsenic. I mean, he had all the symptoms of arsenic poisoning, but that opened up the door for Teddy Roosevelt to become his vice president in 98 or 99. And at which point, as soon as Teddy Roosevelt was in, who was a complete Anglophile, pro-KKK, bombastic figure, he was a tool. At that point, there was nothing really keeping McKinley alive, and he was eliminated in 1901. And he was the last Lincoln Republican. And his assassin was, again, tied to a terrorist, an anarchist network tied to Emma Goldwyn, who was herself tied to British intelligence. It was Bertrand Russell who got her out of prison and actually running the Neo-Malthusian League that they were both a part of. then you
That's very interesting that I'd like to get into. Go ahead. Sorry.
Then you got Warren Harding, 1923, also fighting to bring back the protective tariff, a lot of national banking policies. And he's eliminated by eating bad oysters. FDR, very suspicious circumstances in 1945, April 12th, where he didn't get to live out his last term or see through a lot of the post-war plans that he had worked on with his allies in Russia and in China or other parts of the world. So he didn't get to see that through. His allies like Henry Wallace and Dexter White ended up either dying mysteriously like Dexter White or being run out of government for being pro, you know, like Soviet agents or something. Stalin himself had gone on record to Roosevelt's son saying that your father's death was caused by poisoning by Churchill's gang. And then finally, JFK, everyone has, I think, a memory and a connection to JFK's untimely murder and cover up, followed by his brother, who was in all likelihood going to be the president if he had been permitted to survive the coming months after 1968.
There was also in 1912, the first central bank was formed in Australia that was actually using the American system of just issuing the money, and it was Australia thrived. They funded their participation in World War One, and all these industries were developed, and he died mysteriously of food poisoning. So.
Yes, and that was a Hamiltonian bank. The founder of that, of the Australian National Bank, was a follower of Alexander Hamilton, was spreading Alexander Hamilton's writings across the Australian establishment. Yes, mm-hmm. absolutely. And in Canada at that time as well, you had Wilfrid Laurier, who was trying to move in that direction. He was a great lover of Abraham Lincoln, who was, and Laurier was prime minister for about 14 years from the 1890s, and he was ousted in 1911. But he loved Lincoln. He wanted to apply a protective tariff and emit large-scale credit for big infrastructure development. He foresaw a Canadian population of 60 million in a highly electrified industrial society within 20 years. Keep in mind, today it's only 33 million. now, he was ousted as well in a coup d'etat that was run by the Roundtable Group, which was an organization set up by the funds of Cecil Rhodes that had recently just passed. He'd passed away. He was a diamond magnate and imperialist in South Africa, Rhodesia, Zimbabwe, that whole area. And his funds were put to use in creating not only the Rhodes Scholarship Program, which to this day has contaminated and brainwashed a lot of really talented young people around the world for over a century, but also a series of think tanks that originated with the Roundtable movements, which were all designed to reinstate a world empire under the British command and recapture the lost colonies of the United States. That's in Rhodes's 1877 Confessions of Faith Will. That was sort of the manifesto of his organization. So this group.
Yeah, you had a great quote in there that I wasn't even aware of from Malthus. The whole Malthusian idea that populations grow geometrically and food only grows linearly or whatever, and therefore you've got to cull the population every once in a while. Yeah. So I'm just going to read this quote because I thought it was so good. Malthus, this is right out of your book. Malthus stated so cold-bloodedly in his 1799 essay on population, we should facilitate instead of foolishly and vainlessly endeavoring to impede the operations of nature in producing this mortality. And if we dread the too frequent visitation of the horrid form of famine, we should sedulously encourage the other forms of destruction which we compel nature to use. In our towns, we should make the streets narrower, crowd more people into the houses, and court the return of the plague. What is that? Ring a bell. Plague back today. Well, I don't want to get too far into conspiracy theories, but I think that was remarkable that he said. And then from there, you have the whole Darwinian. Well, anyway, you can pick up the thread if you want at that point or not.
Sure. Yeah, that's a whole juicy thought experiment right there. But yeah, like Malthus people will often say, oh, but he was just a mathematical philosopher and an economist. That has no bearing necessarily on politics. It's like, no, I'm sorry. This is 1799. The man was working at the British Haileybury College, which trained all of the British East India Company directors, economists, everybody, John Stuart Mill, the Benthamites, everybody came through and were processed in Haileybury College under Malthus. That was like the organizing principle of empire. So yeah, that was directly, that had direct political application. And the idea was, yeah, that the primary responsibility for the overlords of society managing the world was to know that always human beings are these hedonistic little eating pollution pooping machines that will always reproduce themselves at a faster rate than nature can provide for. And thus you can sort of mathematically determine approximately when the crisis point will happen, when our population will overexceed our ability to sustain it. And we can act before that happens responsibly as good social engineers, to use, as Malthus directly said in his Essays on Population that you quoted from, these various gifts that the Lord has given us. And he was a parson. He was a reverend. gifts. The Lord has given us great gifts to regulate the herd and cull it according to, you know, wars, famine, disease, and not occur. So all of this is very nasty. Now, the problem is, scientifically, it wasn't taking off because the American experience during the 1800s, especially under Alexander Hamilton's system of the protective tariff, national banking, large scale projects like the Erie Canal, which was the biggest infrastructure project in history at that time, was proving that Malthus was wrong. And when you do things a certain way in your political economy, people can get smarter, you can make more discoveries, and you can apply those discoveries to new inventions and technologies that allow you to overexceed, to break those carrying capacities of nature, those limits, right? And you can create new resources when you apply things like electricity. That was formerly, when you were ignorant of electricity, it was just something that dominated you and burnt your houses down. When you became knowledgeable about the nature of electricity, you could then utilize it and it could be incorporated into the productive process. That totally changed the formula, and it changed your relationship with the periodic table of elements. Well, that came later under Mendeleev, but the point is, it changed our relationship to nature, and we could have more people at a higher quality of life, living longer, living happier, more use of their minds, less use of their physical bodies, we're not physically that different from animals, like monkeys and stuff, physically. So anyway, you brought up Darwin. And so when you start looking at where does Darwin come from? I mean, his book on the origins of species was 1859. Malthus wasn't taking off very well. People were like, well, if we do things, yeah, the way the British Empire wants us to do, yeah, the Malthus principle works, or it applies. But if we do things this other way that we see coming out of the United States, all of a sudden we find, you know, the US's population quadrupled in 40 years from 1790 to 1830. So it doesn't work anymore. The formula breaks. So people weren't buying it. They were believing that there was something divine in the mind of humankind that was an infinitely tappable resource that you could continuously develop and grow without necessarily any physical limits. The mind is an immaterial metaphysical thing, right? That's where justice, ideas of truth that are not something you could break into parts exist. And we can apply it with effects in the material world, which is a great philosophical problem. And that's the foundation of the American system. When you read Alexander Hamilton's writings or Henry C. Carey or Lincoln, they're always talking about that. It's very clear and electric in their minds. It's not an ambiguous thought like it is today for many people. So Darwin, we're told, you know, he's this great genius, and he discovers like a new law organizing the evolution of species, which formerly people had thought of as just, I mean, many people had still thought of the Bible as sort of a literalist thing, and that species just all came into being. What you have now is all that's ever been, but not all. I mean, there are a lot of scientists you know, there's people like James Dwight Dana, Benjamin Silliman, American, these were great American scientists tied to the Alexander von Humboldt networks of scientists around the world, who were all also looking at the fact that, yes, there seem to be these fossils, that species disappear, new species come to being. And there was a fight over, is it random? Is it what's the principle that causes new species to come online and old species to disappear? People like James Dwight Dana were zeroing in on principles like directionality, like cephalization was one example, was one concept that there was always an increasing, the unifying process in biology was that you would find species capable of more sovereign control of having a centralized prefrontal cortex and neurological system that would be organized in the head that would then organize the body in ways that were, again, directional. It wasn't just random mutations governed by, like what Darwin would say would be, you have random mutations in the small, somewhere down there, just causing changes randomly, like rolling the dice. Kind of like what Adam Smith says the free markets are. It's, you know, you get random hedonistic desires of people who want to maximize pleasure and avoid pain. And then you have these organizing principles organized by hidden hands that create wealth, that create creative leaps. But it's very, very mystified. And that was sort of the Darwinian idea too, is, you know, you have these random mutations and governed by these desires to hedonistically, for creatures to have sex, spread their seed, beat out the weaker in the diminishing race for food and sex in an environment that's constantly being reduced of its abundance by the existence of living things. And out of that tension that's caused by various species racing in a world of diminishing returns, you have the certain attributes like, you know, the growth of a slightly longer talon or claw will then win out to kill the weaker species that don't have that long claw or longer beak. And that will gradualistically cause species that are weaker to go extinct as the survival of the fittest spreads itself over the system.
Yeah. Now, I don't want to get too far off the money questions because we don't have too much time.
Sure. But just to wrap it up quickly.
That all came from
Darwin saying directly in his autobiography that he got his theory from reading Thomas's Malthus's theory on populations, and that gave him the germ seed to develop his theory, and that itself just was used to justify empire and empire's ability to rape and destroy weaker countries and weaker people and nations as it spread itself around the world. Just to finish that thought, that was ultimately.
Yeah, okay. And I'll just add one. I know that, you know, I've read different people that cooperation is actually works better in nature than the dog eat dog sort of basic principle of Darwinian evolution. Yes. Yeah.
Absolutely. Agreed.
Yeah. Okay, great. I have a ton of questions that I'm obviously not going to get through. So you talked about various revolutions like the French Revolution, and it failed. And why did it fail? It also had a monetary component. Can you do that real quick?
How long do we have for this interview?
45 minutes, but...
In total?
That was the... Well, it's an hour show, and we always do like 15 minutes.
Oh, boy. Okay. So I got to go fast here, right?
Well, Walter cut some out. He'll cut this.
Okay. Yes, French Revolution. That was Benjamin Franklin didn't want, and that's my first chapter, is the American Revolution was an international revolution, which was only made possible by Benjamin Franklin's international networks stretching not only from Prussia and Germany and especially France, where Franklin, you know, he was the ambassador to France for a very long time, but also Russia. That, you know,
I don't really want you to talk faster because then it's hard to understand. So.
Oh, okay.
If we go over, he'll cut it out, but you know, he'll pick out. I mean, I've rambled. He can cut those things out. Okay, yeah, go ahead.
So yeah, the French the American Revolution itself was an international revolution, and the idea was that after it was a success in America, it was going to spread to first France, where there was a very strong Republican network organized by Ben Franklin that was going to put this into action as a springboard into the rest of Europe in order to liberate Europe as a whole from the system of hereditary controls. Unfortunately, after the tennis court oath, and that was going good in 1789 under Jean-Sylvain Bailly, who was known as the Ben Franklin of Europe, of France, and he was the world's leading astronomer. He was the mayor of Paris, and he was the head of the tennis court oath, the National Assembly that had organized sort of the Declaration of Independence of a sort in France. And you had people like Lavoisier, the chemist, and many others working as leaders of this grouping. Unfortunately, it turned very quickly into a Jacobin anarchist bloodbath. And there's been a lot of research done. I cited from some of it regarding people like Robespierre, Danton, Marat, and others of the Jacobin controllers who were directly tied to British intelligence and who had essentially turned this positive potential into anarchy, which resulted very quickly in the lopping off of the heads of all of the great Republican revolutionaries, including Bailly and Lavoisier and many others. And it eventually, just without any leadership that was able to keep their heads, that were qualified, it turned into 5 years of Jacobins who were basically the believers in the wisdom of the mob, the uneducated mob. And it was very antagonistic to anybody who professed themselves to be amongst or categorizable by the elites. And then on the other hand, you had the Girondins, who were the groups organized around the elites who were saying, look at what happens when you let the mob just rule. It just causes devastation on every level. Let's get control back. And they imposed the 10-day week and the decimal system for everything, including the year. And it was very, very absurd. Cartesian response of just, you know, we have to use pure logic now to restore order. And they killed a bunch of Jacobin leaders. The Jacobins took back control. They killed a bunch of Girondins. It was a disaster. And in the vacuum of leadership, it could only be filled by a fascist, essentially, in the form of Napoleon, who ran roughshod over Europe for 20 years, which resulted in the destruction of a lot of the Republican movements in Poland, in Ireland, and elsewhere. Many of these groups, including the Polish leaders as well as the Irish leaders, were working in with the Continental Congress during the American Revolution, and they lost everything by the late 1790s. And so it was a British operation to destroy and disrupt this positive potential from manifesting itself in Europe.
But there was also a financial aspect. The same, yeah. Anglo-Dutch were they? I don't remember. Bankers came in and did the usual IMF sort of.
Yes.
Yeah. Do you want to say?
Yeah, sure. I mean, essentially, there was a free trade agreement worked out with the Philippe Égalité and the finance minister of France, who were, they basically worked out a British free trade agreement that gave Britain the rights to purchase a lot of the, or all essentially, as much as they wanted, of the wheat and grain of France. France was not allowed under this 1786 free trade agreement. They were not allowed to use protective tariffs. If, you know, it became basically the free market.
They did all that because they were in debt, right? I mean, they agreed.
They were highly indebted. Yeah, they were highly indebted.
So the same situation as we have today, with particularly with underdeveloped countries.
Exactly. Yeah. And they were able to take advantage of France's massive indebtedness. There was speculation against the French currency as well as economic warfare was concerned. They were able to purchase all of the grain reserves so that France had nothing if a harsh winter were to hit, which is exactly what happened. That resulted in the 1789 there's destruction of food crops. They had no food backups, and the population was easily now hungry and used as a battering ram to storm the Bastille, which was an inside job in many ways, kind of similar to 9/11.
So, and we avoided that in the U.S. by printing money, right? By printing our own currency, the continental currency. And that's when Franklin said, isn't it amazing, you know, that these poor colonists won a war against the world's major superpower without any money, just by printing their own. So why didn't the French do that, right? Was that just a new concept that hadn't been tried?
Well, I think that there was a lack of proper leadership. Marquis de Lafayette, who was really responsible, he could have done the most good and understood this Hamiltonian principle the most. He was incapable, though he loved the Republican cause, he was incapable of breaking from his nobility and his affinities or loyalties to the royalty. So even though in Spain you had a national land bank, you sort of had a national bank under King Carlos in the 1780s, who was no king during that time can be said to be good, but he definitely wasn't your typical king, King Carlos, and he was the brother of Marie Antoinette. But he did care about the people. He's one of those types of kings who actually did care. And he utilized with a Republican network in Spain who were preparing to do something similar as what was going on in France. These were all very connected networks, sometimes operating through Freemasonic networks that were not part of the British Empire for passing intelligence and coordination. As a matter of, it's just, you had to have those things. But he had a national bank that was investing in sort of like Hamiltonian style credit. It was then known as, they wouldn't call it that, it was called dirigism. That was what Hamilton had modeled his system around, was Colbert's dirigism of France after the 30 Years' War, to basically direct credit from the treasury instead of into wars or speculation. You direct it into the public good, building schools, building canals, building roads and other things, you know? So the idea is infusing real value by increasing the physical qualities of life of the people by making money work and serve the purpose of the nation.
So was actually money that was just created on the spot, or it was loans that were sovereign credit that was created?
Loans. So they were creating both. They were directing treasury, their treasuries towards action and development, but also you had the growth under Colbert of debts that were tied to future projects. So you could say that was the creation of debts, but the debt wasn't just a passive debt that was becoming inflationary. It was tied to an anti-inflationary physical economic process. And in the case of France, it was the great canal building projects of the late 1600s that we saw, you know, do this. But it took on much more coherent form with Hamilton, of course, as the most scientifically advanced expression of that to our very date, you know.
Yeah. And I mean, today, I think we should do that and could do that. But of course, the big objection is it's going to be inflationary, et cetera. I mean, the Fed has done it, but they're not putting the money into productivity. That's the thing we haven't tried, is to print the money for public purposes that are actually productive. I mean, we have printed the money and handed it over to people for unemployment, and then they don't work, which hasn't been a real good solution either. But we haven't tried just printing the money and building stuff, which is, you know, like building the Erie Canal. That obviously worked very well, or the Transcontinental Railroad.
That's exactly. Yeah, it works every time. You've seen examples of that in history. You see it even today. I mean, people will criticize China for many things, but even somebody who's anti-China like Tucker Carlson has to admit, and he did admit this week, you know, in a show that I found pleasurable to watch, that like China's at the very least able to build things. They stop speculation on housing. They see housing as places where people live. They use money for investments in big projects like the Yangtze Three Gorges Dam that brings, you know, abundance of electricity to people who need it and reduces, you know, all sorts of ailments of people that don't have electricity. So if you, whether it's in the present, whether it's in the past, whether it's Lincoln or whether it's Hamilton or whoever, every time this is done, it works. Empires lose their control over the system. People become more free, happier. They live longer. They live better quality lives. And money becomes increasingly recognized as simply a creation of the human mind designed for the purpose of serving human needs, and not being something we worship, you know, in some weird fetishisticky way. It's a technology. We created it, and it could either dominate us, or at least those who control the central banks could dominate us using our belief in money as a new cult religion of the modern age, or we can just use it for doing things we all need as people, right?
Right. And you've linked the understanding the trifold nature of the deep state. It's the same British imperial complex that has been trying to undo the watershed moment of 1776 for over 240 years. In other words, the deep state that we have today that's undermining things is what's been going on for a couple hundred years. Can you explain that? Like the getting too conspiratorial and getting too Well, sure.
I mean,
it's pretty obvious we got something insidious going on here. And
I would say, Ellen, that we infuse dignity and rigor into the word conspiracy again because it's got a bad rap. And I think that you can't really understand anything principled or causal about history if you don't look at intentions by groups.
Right. Well, and conspiracies are the most interesting thing going on. I mean, all through history. I mean, you want to know what was really happening. What motivated that? What are the underlying forces that are bringing that about? But you're saying the same forces are messing things up today. And
yeah, sure. Well, I mean, it's a trend. There's a continuity that transcends individual lives. And that's tough for people because they think often, people can only conspire to get something immediately satisfying for them personally, but it's impossible to think how a conspiracy could transcend a life or multiple lives. Number one, to answer that in the short way, read my book or my series of books on the Clash of the Two Americas. But for good or for bad, there are conspiracies. Conspiracies aren't always bad. There are sometimes, and oftentimes they are good, based upon an idea. Like, for example, Augustine's City of God was part of an idea that human society could be brought online that would be capable of breaking from the past imperial traditions that were in defiance of natural law. And it could be based upon laws that were in conformity with natural law, which Augustine called God's law, which were premised around a moral principle that your laws had to serve the moral needs of society and thus they would be good. Otherwise, they would be seen as a form of violence. And that was made by both Augustine and also later on Thomas Aquinas, who made that argument that a law that is, because laws are made by human beings, right? You got good laws, you got bad laws. How do you judge, right? What's a good or what's a bad law? Martin Luther King Jr. talks about this a lot. And does it conform to the moral truths of nature, which require that human beings live life without fear of the future, fear of want, fear of, the future, fear of starving, fear of war. All human beings want to survive, they want their children to live a better life than they did. That's a part, whether you're Indian or African or Native American or Caucasian, whatever, that's an invariant of all sort of healthy, mature human beings. So if a law is infringing on that, it's a form of violence. It's not legit. It doesn't square with God's law. So
I think you can say the same thing about technology. That, I mean, all these great technologies they've come up with that they could be using against us. Yeah. Well, even including financial, there's a lot of scary things going on in the financial architecture out
there.
Totally. They could also be used to serve the people, So, exactly. So yeah, the trick is how do we capture it in the public interest? I mean, I think that was the trouble with pulling off the Unfinished Symphony. I think the part that's so hard to do is how do you get all these people to, if you have a government of the people, by the people, for the people, they're all sovereign and they all want something. How do you harmonize all their interests into a set of laws that's fair to everyone? Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm a lawyer and I remember spending a lot of time in the law library and I thought, a computer could do this better than I could. Because, that was before they actually had those computerized systems that, so maybe we should have computers for judges, but nobody would want that, of course, because it's way too impersonal. You want a guy that's sitting there with a heart.
I mean, that's the nice story of Solomon, right? I mean, could a computer have done what Solomon did when two mothers were saying that that baby was theirs? And he's like, well, I mean, that was the most non-linear, non-computer-like answer or solution to the problem that anybody could come up with. He's like, let's just cut it in half and give each mom half a baby. That's the solution mathematically, right? That's what a computer would say. But he knew that that would spark and invoke the soul of the actual mother who would say, no, okay, just give it to that other woman, keep the baby alive. And the other woman was like, yeah, okay, do it. So he's like, okay, give it to that lady. That's obviously the mom. So I think that real law should be founded upon. And I think that's why what Lincoln went through, Lincoln was also a lawyer, but he lived in a very different world that understood justice as a real principle and not just something you use as a word to win your fights or win your cases like a boxing match, which, I mean, I took a couple of law classes in university. I was never a lawyer, but I
that was one of the first lessons that our criminal law teacher taught us, who is a privy counselor in Canada. He's like, the first thing that matters, and he's telling a grouping of like 120 students, he's like, the first thing that matters that you all have to keep in mind throughout the rest of your life, whether you become a defense or a prosecution lawyer, is there is justice doesn't matter. It's can you win your case? That was our first law. Lesson number one. I'm like horrified. But how many students are walking out of there thinking that that's the lesson that they're going to take with them, right? Whereas, so in Lincoln's mind, or in Cicero, the great lawyer Republican of Rome, who was trying to stop Rome from becoming an empire, whose head was cut off by Mark Antony, in their minds, they understand that law must serve justice, just like a good economist like Henry C. Carey or Hamilton understands that economics must serve justice, which is all different aspects of the same thing. So I think if we started teaching our kids and really teaching ourselves, reminding ourselves of these realities culturally, you could get an upshift where people could then navigate through the minefield of misinformation, false theories that are given to them, and have an internal litmus test inside their soul to say, okay, this is a theory I'm being told by experts and authorities is something I should adopt as my own programming, as part of my program, as if I was a human computer or a blank slate. But does it pass the litmus test of my internal understanding of justice, my internal conscience and my soul? No, yeah. Oh, it fails. Oh, people will be hurt if I do this. Maybe that's actually a bad theory. Let's look for a better theory that doesn't hurt people, like whatever macroeconomic theories are taught in school today, right? That legitimize austerity and hurting or killing millions of people at the stroke of a pen to pay off unpayable or illegitimate debts that can and should never be paid on behalf of a financier oligarchy, instead of building just water projects or other things that would just make their lives better and then also pay off whatever debts are legit by building something of real value. So yeah, you just got to get people to think in a different, more critical and moral geometry.
I think, my hope is that we're in an age of enlightenment. I mean, that's what certainly just in my lifetime, the amount of information that's coming in right now is just actually overwhelming. But, you know, we have the ability to understand people all around the world. You can just kind of Google it and see some videos and use your heart thermometer and see if you think they're telling the truth. And which we never could do before. It used to be like in World War II, I heard somebody say, you know, all they knew was what the newspaper said, and the newspaper didn't characterize it, you know, about Hiroshima and Nagasaki, you know, the way they characterized it, it made it seem like it was okay because you weren't looking at the people and seeing what was really happening here.
Great point. No, that's absolutely true. And like with the internet today, sure, you could say that there's bad elements because there's so much noise and distraction that takes people off of a productive path. I mean, there's so many distractions with the internet, and it's gotten worse, admittedly, as well in the last few years as algorithms have made it more and more difficult. Like if you try to type in whatever, great reset, the truth or something, forget about it. Like Google's not going to help you, you know? But, you know, so you have to increasingly have more responsibility. Huh?
DuckDuckGo, it's better.
DuckDuckGo's better, yeah. So you have to sort of like have the hunger within you to know what you're looking for and then fill out that picture. But you can't expect to be spoon-fed the way people, like you just described, some people in World War II times were being expecting to be spoon-fed by whatever the media was telling them was going on in Japan. Or gullible people trying to follow what was going on in Vietnam in the 60s. You have to do the work and be more critical, and it requires more responsibility on our minds' part individually to not be passive but be active researchers. And also, the thing I would have discovered that helps me and helps people in my network do this with more resilience is having an intention to communicate and teach, to be a transmitter of it and not just a receiver, a consumer alone, right? Otherwise people get exhausted. They get sort of overwhelmed and burnt out by it. And it doesn't inspire. And you have to do it also with the
idea. I think that's why it's also interesting to me, because I'm always looking for something to write about. Whereas if you were just taking in, you could get quite depressed, really, you know, overwhelmed and depressed.
But, oh, dear God. Yes. Yeah. And you're always looking for like an angle that will find the empowerment inside of the information, right?
Can be useful that can be shaped into a piece of art. I mean, I think art, that is the human thing that differentiates us from AI, that we have soul, you know, we have feeling, we have heart, we have this heart connection, we have love and all those things, but I'm getting way off track.
No, so, I mean, it's totally, no, this is it. This is because I mean, no, I think that the American system really is a quality of it is artistic. It is a form of it's a science and an art of statecraft. Because you're looking at not just the science of what is physically necessary to sustain your people in a self-perfecting system. And that's the whole idea of in order to form a more perfect union, the idea of philosophically of more perfect for an Aristotelian or a computer, that's paradoxical. It's inconsistent. Because to be more perfect, it's either you're perfect or you're getting better, but perfect is a fixed state. Getting better is a changing state. So to stick them both together is would short circuit an artificial intelligence thing, you know, a machine. Whereas philosophically it's truthful. That's, the way we do it isn't just physically to sustain our industrial and agricultural and other needs and infrastructure. That's all needed. But people like Alexander Hamilton or Benjamin Franklin and many others following in their traditions were very much concerned with the aesthetical development of the people as well, which is why you had the investment, federal investments into fine arts buildings, fine arts institutions, music. This was all over the 19th century, especially. This was part of FDR's New Deal, was investments into the arts, drama, Shakespeare, all of that. So that's the soul of the economy. Just having a materialistic system is very mechanical, and it kind of lends you into a technocracy or fascism. And it doesn't give you the creative juice you need to overcome the limits to growth either.
Sophia, the AI robot.
No, who's that?
She's a robot. Got like citizenship in Saudi Arabia or something like that. But anyway, so somebody asked her what she wanted. And she said a soul. That's what she wanted, a soul. I mean, the difference between us and AI is that thing, that heart connection, that creativity, that ability to put things together in an artistic way that speaks to others.
That's beautiful. Anyway. And I would still say I would doubt that was actually Sophia asking for the soul, but rather her programmers who put that in there. Who said, because otherwise, if the computer itself yearned for, had that yearning for something better that's transcendental, for me, that's already the effects of a soul. I would wager a bet that if we dug into that, we would find that answer was pre-programmed by the whoever composed the response mechanisms in the machine.
Okay, we'll talk off camera.
Talk about that later. Okay,
some other evidence on that if you're interested.
Okay. Okay, cool.
All right. Well, that's been real interesting. I could talk for another hour on all that. I had lots of notes of things I didn't get to ask you on. So is there anything you want to wrap up with, your ultimate vision on all this?
I think that we're in a civilizational crisis. And I think anybody who's listening to your show has an intimation of that already. If I believe that there is something very beautiful, obviously, to be saved inside of the United States that could be used as a beacon, something very beautiful that could lend itself to the aspirations of the world for a new type of system based upon cooperation and harmony and brotherhood for the future as well as for the present. It can be saved. It's worth saving. And I say that just because I talk to a lot of people who are gloating foolishly about the imminent collapse of the bubble economy USA empire. And they don't think through, I think, not only this beautiful history that's been kept from us, but also the implications of what that means, the amount of death that's going to entail of a collapse into a dark age, which is just devastatingly bad. I mean, to really think about that, it's unacceptable. So there is something there. And I think that we don't
it's
have a lot of
time to hear from you, a Canadian.
Yeah. No,
you know, if I had said that, people would say, oh, white woman, whatever, white American. But, you know, you're like you say, you're just looking at it from a distance, and that's what you see. So that's great.
Yeah, we're all part of the same ship, right? It could either be the Titanic or we could be on a better ship.
It's a set of principles, and it's a set of principles that we hope to be able to perfect.
Exactly. Humanity is an unfinished process. It will never be a finished process because there's always going to be more to discover. The universe is really, it's bigger than we could possibly imagine. And we need a type of political, economic, legal system and philosophy and culture that is in harmony with the existing laws, not just of today, but also of what we're going to be facing going into the future where, I mean, we have so many dangers that are beyond simply the danger of nuclear war, which is a real danger. But I mean, guaranteed asteroids are going to hit the Earth at different times in the future. Are we going to be prepared for that or not? We're going to have sunspot activity shutting down electronic grids on the Earth like it did in 1989 in Quebec. We lost electricity all over Quebec when a sunspot hit the our grid head on. That was devastating. It could be even much worse. So are we putting into effect decisions today that allow us to prepare for, to create new technologies, to foresee and then intervene upon asteroids and other things like that, oncoming ice ages? Or are we just sitting here like idiots fighting over diminishing returns of resources while we go into, you know, unending wars with maybe Russia or China, like idiots? It's completely a joke if we don't, you know. It's so absurd. So anyway, I'm hoping that people will take this crisis as an opportunity, like the Chinese say, it's the same word, right? Crisis, opportunity, to not just discover some history, but then to change their paradigm in accordance with some necessities. And, you know, you've been putting forth the program for a national banking system on state and federal levels for a long time. Every country can do this. Every country can take back its sovereign controls of its economy, of its banking. It could eliminate unpayable debts that are illegitimate and will never be paid, and turn whatever legitimate debts do exist into productive credit, like Hamilton did, like Lincoln did, like FDR did, for the development needs of our society. We can all do that. That's very accessible. Some countries are already doing things like that. Like, and again, people might not like China, but I don't care. China is doing things like that already as a role model in our world, building massive infrastructure by turning debt into something useful. So Yeah, it works.
Totally. Great talking to you. Thank you so much for all your insights. Very helpful and very interesting. I've been speaking with Matthew Ehret, who is editor-in-chief of the Canadian Patriot Review, a prolific author and lecturer. Author of his latest book is called The Clash of Two Americas, Volume 1, The Unfinished Symphony. And his website is canadianpatriot.org, and you can find his books there.